As total healthcare costs rise in America, people have continued to ask if there's a way to improve the system. In a 2011 New Yorker article, Atul Gawande asks whether it would indeed be less expensive to invest more resources in care for the neediest patients, a process called hotspotting. Gawande offers several examples of enterprising programs across the country that seek to do just that. Jeffrey Brenner was a family physician in Camden, New Jersey, when a highly publicized death from gun violence in his community got him asking questions about the efficacy of Camden's healthcare system. He ended up founding the Camden Coalition of Healthcare Providers to identify and help the costliest patients in the system, generally patients with chronic or recurring medical problems exacerbated by lifestyle and environmental factors. To find these patients, Brenner started with geographic data showing which areas cost the most to local hospitals, but he had the most success just asking doctors in person. Brenner has now stepped down from his family practice to run the Camden Coalition full-time, managing nurses, social workers, and others to conduct home visits and check in consistently with high-risk patients. The program runs primarily on small grants and is seeking more sustainable funding. So far, for 36 patients the coalition is serving, hospital visits have decreased 46% and their bills have reduced 56%. Another example comes from Atlantic City, where Rushika Fernandopoul runs the Special Care Center for Casino Workers with particularly high medical expenses. The Casino Workers Union and the Atlantic Care Medical Center enacted the center when health insurance costs for both organizations became too high to handle. The program is set apart by its health coaches, employees who come from the patient's community, speak the patient's language, and build strong relationships with patients. When one patient was asked why, after her third heart attack, she finally made healthy lifestyle changes, like exercising and eating well, she responded that it was Jayshree, her health coach, because, quote, "she talks like my mother." Such individualized attention and understanding between patients and health workers has, so far, made a remarkable difference, with a 25% drop in medical costs for workers in the program. Quote, "We've been looking to Washington," the New Yorker article says, "to find out how healthcare reform will happen, but people like these, Brenner, Fernandopoul, are its real leaders." The examples of hotspotting we've seen have been relatively localized programs. What might be some of the obstacles to expanding the scale of programs that offer heightened care to high-cost patients? Are these types of programs better suited to be local endeavors?
Hi, my name is Vin, and today I want to discuss the infamous Tuskegee experiments and the effect they had on modern research ethics. So first, a little background. The study, which was called the Tuskegee Study of Untreated Syphilis in African American Men, was a public health endeavor in 1932, which sought to record the natural history of syphilis in black men. A total of 600 men, 399 of which had syphilis and 201 did not, were enrolled in the study. The participants were given an incentive in the form of medical care and free meals. The researchers told these men that they were participating in the study to be treated for bad blood, which was a local term used to describe several conditions and illnesses, including syphilis. The study lasted for 40 years, and when it first began, there were no proven treatments for syphilis. At least, that was the case until penicillin became the standard treatment in 1947. In modern times, if a drug or treatment has been proven to make a difference, researchers are required to stop the study prematurely and give the treatment to the control group. However, such measures were not yet put into place, and this treatment was actually withheld from all subjects. The subjects were never offered the treatment and were not told the truth. This meant that some of the subjects who had syphilis died and/or spread it to their spouses, who then gave it to their children through pregnancy or at birth. This all happened even though there was a very simple treatment that could have saved or helped all of them. In 1972, information about the study and the number of people with syphilis who were not ever offered treatment spread throughout the entire world, sparking international outrage. A panel of people from various fields was put together, and it determined that while the patients participated in the study freely, They did not know the true intentions or even the true name of the study. It was not informed consent. They were not told the truth about their treatments and were left to suffer while the researchers thus observed. The study was then shut down and subjects were compensated with free medical and burial services. The spouses and children were also given those benefits. This study had a major impact on the ethical standards we conform to today when conducting research. The process of informed consent was stressed and became a mandated part of any study involving humans. This also led to the 1979 Belmont Report, which summarizes ethical guidelines for research involving human subjects. It also led to the establishment of the Office for Human Research Protections. The federal government also created new policies and rules when it came to research, most noticeably regulations requiring institution review boards, known as IRBs. These boards review the protocols for a study to make certain they are following ethical guidelines. Overall, this incredibly unethical experiment led to many rules and regulations, especially for studies involving human subjects. It truly stressed the importance of informed consent and completely changed our ethical standards. My question is this: studies like these destroyed people's trust in researchers and even in public health. Why is the trust of the general public important for scientists and researchers?
Shadows settle on the place that you left. Our minds are troubled by the emptiness. Destroy the middle, it's a waste of time. From the perfect start to the finish line. And if you're still breathing, you're the lucky ones. 'Cause most of us are heaving through corrupted lungs, setting fire to our insides for fun, collecting names of the lovers that went wrong, the lovers that went wrong. Most of our feelings, they are dead and they are gone. We're setting fire to our insides for fun, collecting pictures from the flood that wrecked our home. It was a flood that wrecked this home. And you caused it. Most of us are bitter over someone, setting fire to our insides for fun, to distract our hearts from ever missing them. But I'm forever missing him.
Car, a symbol of American pride, independence, power, freedom, and a leading cause of death and injury in the United States. Today, we will be examining the decline in automotive fatalities over the last 100 years. There are two facets to automotive safety: car design and driver behavior. Engineering advances have vastly increased the survivability of vehicular accidents. In the 1930s, the implementation of laminated safety glass prevented glass shards from causing further injury during an accident. In the 1950s, starting with Volvo, a three-point seatbelt was introduced. In 1962, New York enacted a law requiring the manufacturing of seatbelts in the front seats of all cars. However, the seatbelt did not readily catch on. In order to increase public use, automatic seatbelts were implemented. However, these automatic belts were ineffective. To be truly effective, the lap belt still had to be manually buckled. If left unbuckled, the passenger would slide under the shoulder buckle and sustain serious injury. In 1984, New York became the first state to mandate seatbelt use, and most of the other states soon followed. However, public adoption was slow and gradual. A common myth was that being thrown clear of the vehicle was safer than being kept within. Any subscribers to this myth are welcome to hurl themselves through a window at 30 miles an hour onto concrete. Starting in the 1970s, airbags began to be introduced. These prevented the driver and occupants from smashing into the console, and cushioned the movement of occupants within the vehicles. Beginning in 1999, all cars were required to have front airbags. Since then, side, knee, and rear airbags have been designed and implemented. Modification of driver behavior has also improved vehicle safety. Graduated driver's license programs have reduced the high accident rate among young and inexperienced drivers. Laws punish texting or drinking while driving, and research shows that driving while tired may be similarly dangerous. Traffic control measures and intersection design have also helped reduce the probability of collisions. Still, these systems require the driver to be attentive and following the law. New electronic technologies are being developed to automate vehicle safety. Forward collision avoidance systems can warn of an impending collision, prime the brakes, and even automatically stop the car. Lane assist functions can correct or warn a driver if a car is drifting out of lane. Blind spot monitoring systems check for cars on either side of the vehicle, and likewise warn of potential collisions. Backup cameras give a better view of the immediate rear of a vehicle, preventing drivers from accidentally backing over pets or small children. Of course, the issue with all of these features is adoption. These cutting-edge technologies start out in the higher trim lines of vehicles, and take time and legislation to become ubiquitous. Even with these technologies, there is still room for human error. Many see self-driving cars as the answer to many of these concerns. In addition to reducing accidents, synchronization of cars would allow for faster movement of cars through intersections and reduce slowdowns. At the end of the day, we are merely human, and the faster we submit to our robot overlords, the better. This begs the question: what can be done to incentivize people to adopt these new technologies?
Cancer. The word itself strikes fear into most people, and for good reason. In 2017 alone, it is projected that there will be 1,688,780 new cancer cases diagnosed and 600,920 cancer deaths in the U.S. But where did this deadly disease originate? The first descriptions of cancerous tumors date back to 1600 BC,
in ancient Egyptian writing. The ancient Greeks also looked into the causes of cancer. Hippocrates was the first to use the term carcinoma, and Galen, a Roman doctor, was the first to use the word sarcoma for fleshy tumors in the 2nd century. In 1800, Marie-Francois Xavier Pichat was the first to propose that cancer was due to an overgrowth of cellular tissue. This was confirmed in 1830 with the discovery of the microscope and by cellular pathology work done by Rudolf Virchow. In the early 20th century, cancer was finally recognized as a notable problem for society. The American Society for the Control of Cancer, or ASCC, was founded in 1913, and the National Cancer Institute followed in 1937. ASCC became known as the American Cancer Society, or ACS, in 1945. Around this time, there was an effort to both educate the public on cancer and destigmatize the disease, as there was initially a lot of concern that cancer might be contagious. By 1970, cancer had become the second leading cause of death in the United States, after intensive lobbying done by Mary Lasker, a New York philanthropist and volunteer leader of the ACS, and Senator Yarborough, who explored the cancer issue with medical experts, business leaders, and cancer advocates, Richard Nixon declared war on cancer when he signed the National Cancer Act in 1971. The National Cancer Act was referred to as a turning point in the struggle to defeat this disease, and money and resources were allocated to fund research and help the translation of research to treatment. The governmental actions were directed through the National Cancer Institute, through the Public Health Service, and the National Institute of Health, or the NIH. Between the discoveries of the X-ray machine in 1896, the chemical structure of DNA in 1953, and the cure for choriocarcinoma in 1956, substantial progress was made in the diagnosis and treatment of various kinds of cancer. Scientists also recognized that defective genes that can lead to cancer could be inherited, and so early screening for at-risk individuals was key. While there is still a long way to go in the war against cancer, remarkable progress was made in the years following the 1971 National Cancer Act. As a gross average, cancer incidence rates and death rates have both declined towards the last years of the 20th century, while survival rates have increased markedly. Improvements in treatment, survival, and quality of life for people living with cancer have also been made. To quote Richard Klausner, former director of the National Cancer Institute, "We may not know how to cure cancer yet, but we do know what we need to do to get there, and that is very exciting." As we've discussed in class, there are many risk factors for cancer that are easily modifiable by lifestyle changes. If the war on cancer had focused equally as much on preventative measures as it did on research for treatment and a cure, do you think we would have less cancer cases today?
We may look back on this day and this action as being the most significant action taken during this administration. It could be, because when we consider what cancer does each year in the United States, we find that more people each year die of cancer in the United States than all the Americans who lost their lives in World War II. This shows us what is at stake. It tells us why I sent a message to the Congress the first of this year, which provided for a national commitment for the conquest of cancer, to attempt to find a cure.
As a result of the nation's investment in clinical cancer research, more people are surviving cancer than ever before. Today, 2 out of 3 people live at least 5 years after a cancer diagnosis, up from roughly 1 out of 2 in the 1970s. The nation's cancer death rate has dropped 18% since the early 1990s, reversing decades of increases. This progress reflects advances over the last 40 years in every area of cancer care: prevention, screening, chemotherapy, surgery, radiation, and increasingly, molecularly targeted treatments. At the same time, better ways of managing nausea, pain, and other side effects are enabling patients to live better, more fulfilling lives. There have been several milestones in the war against cancer. Let's look in on a few. As we all know, on December 23, 1971, President Richard M. Nixon signed the National Cancer Act, which authorized the NCI director to coordinate all activities of the National Cancer Program, establish National Cancer Research Centers, and establish National Cancer Control Programs. In 1978, the Food and Drug Administration approved tamoxifen, an anti-estrogen drug originally developed as a birth control treatment for the treatment of breast cancer. Tamoxifen represents the first in a class of drugs known as selective estrogen receptor modulators to be approved for cancer therapy. In 1979, the TP53 gene, also called P53, the most commonly mutated gene in human cancer, was discovered. It is a tumor suppressor gene, meaning its protein product helps control cell proliferation and suppress tumor growth. In 1985, results from an NCI-supported clinical trial showed that women with early-stage breast cancer who were treated with breast-conserving surgery followed by whole breast radiation therapy had similar rates of overall survival and disease-free survival as women who were treated with a mastectomy alone. In 1998, results of the NCI-sponsored breast cancer prevention trial showed that the anti-estrogen drug, tamoxifen, can reduce the incidence of breast cancer among women who are at increased risk by about 50%. The FDA approved tamoxifen to reduce the incidence of breast cancer in women at increased risk. In 2003, results of an NCI-sponsored prostate cancer prevention trial showed that the drug finasteride, which reduces the production of male hormones in the body, lowers a male's risk of prostate cancer by about 25%. In 2010, the FDA approved Sipuleucel-T, a cancer treatment vaccine that is made using a patient's own immune system cells, for the treatment of metastatic prostate cancer that no longer responds to hormonal therapy. It is the first, and so far the only, human cancer treatment vaccine to be approved. In 2014, analyzing DNA in cancer became a thing. The Cancer Genome Atlas Project, a joint effort by NCI and the National Human Genome Research Institute to analyze the DNA and other molecular changes in more than 30 types of human cancer, found that stomach cancer is actually 4 different diseases, not just one, based on differing tumor characteristics. The finding and other related projects may potentially lead to a new classification system for cancer, in which cancers are classified by their molecular abnormalities as well as their organ or tissue site of origin. As we have seen, there have been many milestones in cancer research, but of course, we have a long way to go. So I leave you with this discussion question. Do you think the cure to cancer will be in prevention or in treatment? What do you think will be the next big milestone in cancer research?
Thank you.
news, time after time. I've done my sentence, but committed no crime and bad mistakes.